So my talk is going to include a video clip of an Australian born in Melbourne, and he was born without arms and legs, and he went through a rough time, and he managed to overcome his difficulties. He was bullied in school, he's actually an embodiment of how you can change something that you don't like and change into something you like. So we are going to start with that video clip. So we start it like this. I think we start here like this. All right, if you don't love your job, if you hate your job, you might think about it again, because it's all about changing our attitude. It's about changing our attitude. And many people don't have jobs, actually. Can you imagine how many people don't have jobs around the world? In Africa, in Asia, in many countries, people don't have a job. But if you have a job, the first thing you have to thank nature, or God, or Buddha, or whatever, that you have a job. the only problem is that you're hating it. There is something that I learned when I was a student in Uganda. It goes like this. I was doing Christian religious education. They said that you should be contented. You should be contented with life. And in this parable, they said, I was crying that I have no shoes until I found somebody who had no legs. Can you imagine somebody say, oh, I don't have shoes, I don't have shoes. Oh, wait until you see somebody who doesn't have legs. So it's all about contentment, actually. So when we are contented, then we are going to change the world. Okay, let's go to the PowerPoint. I'm going to talk to do the PowerPoint to go through some of the things, like why do we hate our job? Start with, yeah? Just go. So the thing is, when it comes to find meaning in a job we hate, there's a few things we need to know, actually. Okay, thank you very much. All right. So this is our topic, how to find meaning in a job that you hate. All right, so let us look at facts and figures about job situation within Australia. 4 in 5 Australians, that makes about 82%, leave their current role in search for new challenges. So more than half, which is that's a percentage, leave because of limited career advancement opportunities. So national salary growth has decreased from 4.1% in 2012 to 3.2% in 2016. The industries with the biggest decreases in salary growth are construction, retail, finance, manufacturing, metal and auto/auto, and professional services. So the biggest human resource issue for business is organization culture, which is at 63.7, right? So how to find meaning in a job you hate? First we look at, the slide was changed or what? Let me see. All right. Somebody, you see that piles? That shows that there's a lot of work probably. And there's a lot of crying, actually. Most of the time we cry. Eh? Maybe not tears coming, but inside there are tears. All right? So basically, how to find reasons why, actually, that should be why. Why we find reason why we don't find meaning easily. This slide was reshuffled, I think. So, but it should be why. Reasons. One of them is lack of leisure time. Work without play makes Jack a dull boy. Have you heard about that saying? So actually we work so hard and there's no time to go for even walk, go for walking meditation. So workplace flexibility becomes the biggest topic of conversation. So we work 47 hours per week now, and it is no longer such a thing as 40 hours work week. Another study, 64% of managers expect their employees to be reachable outside of the office on their personal time. So as a result, another study, again saying that more than half of workers feel burnout. Those who are volunteers, it's called compassion fatigued. Yes, I hope those who work at BSV, you don't get what you call compassion fatigue. Yeah, it's out of compassion to come and work, but this is actually very common with social workers and health workers. They give a lot, but only to miss what you call renewal. They cannot renew themselves. So that becomes a problem. So we don't have much leisure time because of these phones. Now everybody can reach you. Before, when we used to have those physical phones, you'd turn like this. Once you finish work, done. But now, as you are driving, well, Bhante, can I come? As when you go to your room, there's no privacy. You are in the bathroom, and someone is calling. So you get the phone in the bathroom. And the problem with this kind of technology, it's good, but it pressurizes, it gives us a lot of pressure. Because if you don't respond to the email, people say that you are rude, you know? But guess what? When we are those years, we had to spend 2 weeks before we get some reply. But here you spend one day, people email you, what's wrong? Did you receive my email? So there's a lot of pressure, actually. So we have to even reply our emails when we go back, when we should be with our children and our loved ones and have a cup of tea, watch television and all these things. So now, this is out of the window. That's where we are, stress and distress. So the increased use of mobile devices and technologies have caused the lines between work and personal life to become blurred. Leaving employees under more pressure to be connected 24/7, even when you are sleeping, and unable to find healthy balance. Actually, it happened to me. I was sleeping when I came here the first time, and then I had a phone ringing, and then it woke me up. So now I don't put on my phone. And it was these people sending WhatsApp and all these things, somebody from German, from everywhere. So I said, no, I'm not going to switch on my phone. So you cannot send me WhatsApp at night and I attend to that, or Vibe or whatever. I just need my sleep. The world can wait. Yes. So switch off your phone at night. But it's up to you to make that decision. Yeah, otherwise clients are going to call you. You see, this now is a global village. The world is a global village. So you are working in Melbourne, but you have friends in London and Africa and all this. So you are going to keep on getting phones and all these things. I remember when I was working in India, as you know, I wasn't born a monk, in case it's not obvious to you. So I was working in India, New Delhi, and then we had the office in New York. And as we are starting to sleep in India, New York people are waking up. So then I'm telling you, I could not sleep very well. The net effect, every day I was sleepy during daytime. So I know what it means actually to be connected 24/7. It's because now we work with different offices. And that's what we have done all over the world. Offices are shifting to India. And all these things, then you're working, but you're working with so many offices. So and the time differences are, of course, are different. Okay, then unemployment and unemployment. More supply of workers and less jobs.
So this is a problem. There's more students graduating and not many jobs are generated. More so in poor countries like Uganda. We have 18 universities or so. Many students graduate, but work is not does not increase, at least proportionally. So that's a problem. In many ways, it's inverse proportion, you know. The relationship between jobs and workers, it's inverse proportion. So millennial, that's people from 20 to 35, yes, the most educated generation in history. This sounds exciting, but this, but with the supply of educated workers much higher than demand for them in the workforce, it has created a perfect storm of unemployment and underemployment, and a flat-out frustrating beginning to our career. So as soon as we start, that's the frustration we face. So we are the first in the modern era to have high levels of student loan debt, poverty and unemployment, and lower levels of wealth and personal income than any other generation at the same stage in of life. So this is the trend. So jobs get lost to robots. Companies figure out how to automate more jobs and modernize their workplaces at the cost of employees. I went with him last time to Coles. Was it Coles? I was so surprised that you go to the supermarket and then you get everything you want, and then you are the one who scan it and then go. So you are losing now human beings. How many jobs get lost? In Uganda, we are not there yet. But I remember one time I was in the United States in 1990. It was winters, and then we had a flat tire. We went to the next petrol station. There was no single human being. I felt very sad, I'm telling you. I'm the one who had to help the poor guy to change the tire and all these things. In Uganda, we don't have any automated petrol station. But guess what? It's coming there. It's a question of time. So now we lose so many jobs. So the contributing factor include minimum wage increases, companies striving to create more business value with fewer expenses, the rising cost of healthcare, pressure to be modernized, and advances in robotics. It's predicted that machines might be able to do half of our jobs within the next 2 decades. I think within the next decade, I think, because it's amazing, you know. For me, I used to study it in books when I was doing economics in Uganda about how robots are replacing people. I didn't know actually the impact of this until I went to the first world countries, you know. So many things are done by machines, you know, to vending machines. You go to there and, the place, and then you get a cup of tea, cup of coffee, and all these things. Yet when you I was in Brazil, you ask people, "Can I? Where is this road? Does this road lead to Rio de Janeiro?" You strike a conversation, and then you end up being friends. But these days, I don't know how we are going to overcome stress, because most of the time we are dealing with machines. But maybe when I have a stress and I ask a wonderful person and they smile at me, maybe that would make my day, you know? But the smiles, the machine is not going to smile at you. Unless they make a smiling machine. You put in money there to get a cup of tea. How are you? Go, go, go. They should actually do that. That will help us with the stress. But I'm telling you, for me, before I went actually to Brazil, they told me, okay, come to Bahia, come. You love Brazil, you just ask, where are you going? And people just say, sit down and have a cup of tea. And then I'm telling you, when I went there, it's amazing. You ask, you just greet somebody. Then they say, oh, where are you come from? And all this. People ask you, where are you coming from? Are you from Africa? What are you doing? Yes, you know, people help us to deal with the stress, you know, but now it's not there. And for me, when I was in one time in San Jose, in California, I met these Africans. They're from Ethiopia. They asked me, "What are you doing?" I said, "I'm doing meditation." "Oh, you are medication. You are medicating." I said, "No, I'm meditating." "Oh, sorry, you are sick." They said, "I'm sorry." I mean, they said, "We are sorry." I said, no, don't be sorry. I'm meditating." So though they misunderstood what I was doing, but at least I was very happy that at least there are some people who don't know what about meditation, and then I have to strive to define meditation for them. Actually, leave alone this incident, I was so surprised to find out people don't know what meditation is about. You ask people define meditation, they just keep on blinking their eyes. They look, "I don't define meditation." Anyway, the story is like this, that even people who don't know what meditation and think that is medication, they make you happy. But now with robots, no, we are not happy at all. Other factors, conflict in purpose of life and in job. Actually, these days we have a lot of conflict of purpose of life and in job. Actually, first and foremost, most people don't know what's the purpose of life. I did I gave a talk in Uganda at our temple. I invited many young people. I asked them, "What's the purpose of life?" People could not give me a purpose of life. People say, why should life have a purpose? Others say, "No, life, there's no purpose." So actually, if we don't articulate the purpose of life, that means also we cannot articulate the purpose of your job. No wonder you fail to find meaning, because you don't know the purpose of life. So then I think most of the time it's about even conflict of the purpose in your life and also the purpose of your job. So whenever there's a conflict, then you, of course, fail to find meaning in your job. So, what's the purpose of life? Let us take a little bit of input here. What's the purpose of life? Who can tell me the purpose of life? And then you say, I want always to discussion a little bit. What's the purpose of life? Let me start. I think, what's the purpose of life? I'm just put you on the spot. Some people thinking that even people think like me asking the purpose of life, that's the purpose of life. Can you believe? People think that me asking that what's the purpose of life, you have already got now the purpose of life. Other people think that the purpose of life is no purpose. So what's the purpose of life? I'm going to choose another person. Upasakama. What's the purpose of life?
I think it's different for each person.
Uh-huh. Why are we here? That means if you also you go to the job, you might start asking this tough question. Why am I doing this job? Anyway, you don't have to find the answer. These answers you'll find yourself. Okay. Mismatch of suitability. In other words, there's a mismatch of your job and also your skills. So in other words, when I went in India, because they had caste systems, I found so many people, they had graduated with a master's degree in commerce. And for me, I went to India to study a bachelor's degree of commerce. And commerce was a very, very much needed skill in Uganda. So the government of India gave me the scholarship to study in India, bachelor's degree in commerce. So when I started going to buses, I found people had a master's degree. I was so frustrated. How can somebody have a master's degree and for me I'm just looking for a bachelor's degree so that I go to my country to make life? People in my country who had a bachelor's degree, they were working in very good jobs. And these people are bus drivers. So now you can see an accountant working as a bus driver. Do you think that person will find meaning in life? Maybe difficult. after spending all 16 years, and then there's a mismatch between the skills and the job. So there's a bit of a mismatch because there's not enough jobs. So people graduate as computer graduates, and they end up doing something different, and then they're not satisfied. They cannot find a meaning in life. They hate their jobs. There's also out-of-domain issues. Those who are Buddhist, we know about right livelihood and noble eightfold path. So some people, they go and get a master's degree in a business, and they end up working in a slaughterhouse, basically. There was a mismatch there between the domain, because our domain, it depends on your religion, but we Buddhists, we follow the noble eightfold path. And part of the noble eightfold path is right livelihood. So if you get a job, and then it may not be suitable for your beliefs and all the things, what you uphold, your values. So that's another problem why we fail to find a meaning. Another one, delusional motives. Peer pressure. Yeah, let's go to Tasmania and be tour guides. No, I want to do my computer work in a computer company and be a computer analyst. Let's go to Tasmania. It's cool. So then we follow our friends, you know, and then we don't find meaning in their job. Another one, parent pressure. You should become a doctor. Especially if you have one son only or one daughter. And your parents have pumped a lot of money to go to study in these countries. You people, you don't know how much money people pay in these developing countries to send their children to the so-called developed countries. A lot of money. They save a lot of money, and they put a lot of pressure. These kids you are seeing here, they have a lot of pressure. They are sitting on a mountain of pressure. They have to qualify as doctors, and they have to work as doctors. But the children want to be musicians. Now they have to be doctors. In fact, I had a story, one person became a doctor, and then he became a musician, basically just gave up being a doctor. And he was a good student, could not find a meaning, you know? So I think this is a few factors I found out. Why we need to find meaning in a job? So importance of job satisfaction and happiness. Workplace happiness is not a luxury in such a world. It's a necessity if we are to maintain our individuality, patience, and sanity. We spend almost a third of our day at the office, and even during our downtime, we still thinking about our jobs. Wouldn't it be a payoff to actually like what we do? Happiness is directly proportional to productivity. Research shows that workers who have good culture fit to their organization are a third more productive, three times more creative, and almost 90% less likely to quit. So culture fit accounts overall for around two-thirds of the differences between people in both job satisfaction and performance. Poor fit is estimated to cost the U.S. industry $15 billion a year. 68% of the new hires that fail within a month do so because of this. I told you about proper fit, you know, about suitability. So this is very, very important to know, the relationship between happiness and productivity. So you better be happy, in other words, for your job. Okay, how do we find meaning in a job that you hate? These are the few things that I've aligned. There are 5 points that I think we're going to discuss the remaining time. If you don't find meaning in life, you can actually do it by a few things. One is called replacement method. So in other words, you have to replace ingratitude with gratitude. Okay, so from ingratitude to gratitude. So be thankful to your work to the fact that you at least you have a job. This will be at least, all right? At least you have a job. So this one, I mentioned it at the beginning of my talk, but really be thankful, because many people are redundant. They don't have job in their countries. Like in India, so many people are there. Actually, it's because there's no jobs, but they have this caste system that even when you have a PhD in accountants, you'll never get a job of accounting. You have to be a bus driver. So in that country, they have this problem of caste system. And other countries like in Africa, the problem is actually they don't have enough resources. They don't have enough resources. So they have maybe gold, they have oil, but it's a lot of money to extract oil. So then they leave all these resources non-tapped. So people keep on graduating, and then they don't have jobs. Many, many countries, but if you can land a job, better find a way how to be grateful. So how to be grateful to your work? At work, what do we find there? We found work, we find boss, even when the boss is from hell. We found coworkers, isn't it? So be grateful to them so that you can live harmoniously there. So can you go to your boss and say, I'm very grateful for giving me the job every day? You say, I'm very grateful. Can you say that? Yeah, do so. And then your coworkers, I'm very grateful that we are working together. Then you can even from time to time give a cup of tea. Can I make a cup of tea for you? Get the best cup of tea they like, or coffee. If your boss likes coffee from Brazil or coffee from... Can I make you a cup of tea or a cup of coffee from Uganda? Then, show some gratitude. Instead of complaining about profits and losses and redundance and all these things, try to find out something. You can be grateful. Find something about a job, you know, that you can be grateful of. The best way to do this is to maintain gratitude journal. Have a journal, a book, and every day write something good about your job. It's amazing. By the end of the week, you are going to have so many, many good things. At least 7 things you like about your job. Who has ever done that? Let us be really, really... Have you... there's one person there. So do you every day write a good thing about you like about your job? Actually, not only about your job, about life. Raise your hand if every day you write something you like good about your job. That's very good. Only one person. Oh, 2-3 people. That's very good. So as soon as you wake up, instead of thinking, oh, my computer is not working, all this, I'm going to go to work, just, oh, I'm grateful to be alive. I'm awake. I'm alive. I'm healthy. Are we grateful to life like this? That I'm grateful to life. I'm grateful to my breath. Who has ever expressed gratitude to the breath? Raise your hand. To the breath is what keeps us alive, but we are not grateful to the breath. So we have to find out small things we have to be grateful in life and in work. And then, of course, have a journal like this. Monday, Tuesday, whatever, and write good thing. By the end of month, you'll find out actually you have more things we are grateful of than things that you're not grateful of. But if you don't write them, you forget. And revise it so that you don't lose the focus, you know. You keep on revising. Oh, I'm very grateful to this job because what? What could be the one thing you are grateful of your job? Because I'm learning new skills. with even a bad job, you learn few skills like communication skills, interpersonal skills. There's a lot of job opportunities, maybe to learn communication, writing, maybe even communicating with people abroad, maybe travel opportunities. I'm going to ask you one question. You have to answer though. I have three watches, clocks, three clocks, right? One clock loses 1 minute per hour. One clock loses, let's say clock A, loses 1 minute per 1 hour. Another clock loses 10 minutes per 1 hour. Are we together? Clock B loses 10 minutes per 1 hour. I have another clock, clock C, stopped working long time ago. It doesn't work. So tell me which clock shows correct time more often. No. I want to choose. There are three clocks. Which clock shows correct time more often? Please don't share answers. Eh? Clock A? Eh? Yeah. Which clock? No clock. You need more time to think? No, let me just put on, because, okay, another person. The last one? But it's dead.
Yeah, but doesn't it have the time shown on the clock?
No, it shows.
It shows sometimes?
Yes.
So isn't that
common? Another person. This clock loses, clock A loses only one minute per 1 hour. Are you? Which? Eh?
Clock C.
Another person?
Clock C is twice a day, it's right.
Eh?
Clock C, because twice a day, at least it's right.
Yes, you have passed it, because I've been asking this question. Most people say clock A. It's all, after all, it's 1 minute, after 1 hour. So this, I ask people, even something that doesn't work, twice a day it works. So even... Even more correct. You know, the first time this happened, to really prove this, I went to Japan. You know, Japan, there's a place called Hiroshima. They bombed Hiroshima. And the clock, that time they bombed, there was a clock, and it stopped working. And I happened to be there around lunchtime. Then I said, wow, this clock is so old. How come it's correct? I looked whether it's time for lunch or to eat something. I said, this. Then it reminded me, actually, it's actually, even if it's old, it stopped working in 1945, but every time, twice a day, it would show correct time. So even your bad job, you'll find always something meaningful. And even something that you hate, you always find something, there's something that you love. The only thing that you haven't made enough effort to really find it out. That's why I tell you, maintain a diary. Right? It's very, very important. Okay, then from contentment, you are replacing it with contentment. Contentment means that you love the contents of your life, the contents of your job. So, in other words, be contented with what is suitable, be contented with what's within your means, and be contented with what's available. What's available is your job. It's available. So be contented with it. Most of the time, I think there's even a saying. In other words, appreciate your job. I found a saying, I think it's a Greek proverb, like, how do you make a man appreciate his horse? How do you make a man or a woman to appreciate his or her horse? How do you make it? This is a proverb. How do you make a man or a woman appreciate his horse or her horse? How do you do that? take it away. Once they take away the horse, they'll start appreciating the horse. So you may not appreciate your job, that is very, there's no meaning to it, it's a waste of time, you hate it, but the day you lose it, you're going to start to see a change. So that's why it's very, very important to be contented with your job. All right, number two, technique number two is called reflection. So focus on the strength and the opportunities and not so much on the weakness and the threats, right? So what are the strengths of your job? What are the strengths? Paycheck. You earn money. That's strong. Another one, career development. Another one is skills. You develop many skills when you're working. Patience. Actually, when you're working, you have to develop the skill of patience. Because unless you're working in a company where all people are enlightened, is that the companies you work? All people are enlightened, all our hands. So you have to be patient with your boss. You have to be patient with your co-workers. So this is what you learn, actually. You learn determination. You learn many things, actually. Well, what are the opportunities? Socializing. We are actually social animals, human beings are social animals. We have to socialize in order to survive. So we actually speak with friends, we develop many friendships. Some people get their wives and husbands there, or boyfriend and girlfriend. I mean, thank God to work. So it is giving you more opportunities, even when you're married or something like that. But you get people who are understanding. And also you get people not understanding, very difficult people. And guess what? When you have difficult people, you develop what you call spiritual muscles. You know spiritual muscles? Spiritual muscles is actually your strength of your mind, the strength of your mind. You know you have strength of your body to lift things, but you need the strength of your mind. Now, when you are at work, you meet people who are unkind. Is that familiar to you? Either your coworkers? If you actually don't meet those people, you'll have a weak mind. But once you meet difficult people, they give you some, it's like a mirrors. Difficult people are like a mirrors. They show you exactly where you are, what you are. Yeah? Like a mirror doesn't say, oh, today you are ugly or beautiful. The mirror just shows you what's going on. So now those difficult people shows you what you must do. Friendly people who smile at you, they tell you what you should do. But difficult people, they tell you what you must do. What do you do? What you must do? Pienji, practice meditation. Learn a little bit of handling your emotions. That's what difficult people are telling us. That's what the job is telling us. The difficult job, you can't find meaning. It tells us, hey, try to find meaning. Maybe you have neglected the meaning of life. That's why you don't find the meaning in job. So try to go backwards and try to find meaning in life. Then you find meaning in job. If you find meaning in job, in life, you find also meaning in job. So it teaches you something, okay? So what are the threats? The threats of your job? Boss from hell? That's a threat. So you can always deal with them because they are the teachers. Call them, these are teachers. When you find somebody like your boss who's very difficult and you hate your job because of a boss, say, this boss is my teacher. He's the one who's going to teach me and I might even get enlightened. Of course, there are some weaknesses here and all these things. But how about focusing more on the strength and the opportunities other than always dwelling on weaknesses only and threats? Okay, another method of how to love your job is called redirection. Redirect your mind. These are the three ways I can give you. Finding volunteer work which offers satisfaction. In other words, you can balance your regular job with volunteer work. So that's why we have some people coming here to do some kind of volunteerism. They come here. You see volunteers live longer. They have made a research. Come to Uganda. Come to Uganda for 3 months and come back to Australia. You keep on alternating. What this does is that you get a break. You get some kind of break. Everybody needs a break from time to time. It's not so bad to have what you call yin and yang. Actually, it was amazing. My uncle is a Christian. He's amazing. He spent most of the time doing volunteer work, and he had also a company. I was wondering, why does he spend all the time with lottery club, this and that? But now I know why. Do you have a regular job in your free time? Come and volunteer. Because volunteering gives you a lot of more meaning in life, because you are helping yourself and helping others, and you're helping both. Some, we might get stuck in a work whereby actually it's more of like, it's like a roller coaster, you know? It's as if you're just only helping your boss only to get better. But when you volunteer, you get in touch with the entire human beings, who they are suffering and all, and all this, then you can actually see a big picture of your job. In other words, it gives you a big picture of your life. And also it creates happiness that you are helping others. There's a Chinese saying, I don't know whether it's appropriate here, but I will flash it out. There's a Chinese saying which said that if you want to be happy, for 1 hour, take a nap. If you want to be happy for 1 hour, take a nap. If you want to be happy for 1 day, go fishing. I say it's not a Buddhist thing, but I have to say it. If you want to be happy for one day, go fishing. So if you want to be happy for 1 month, get married. Don't take it personally. If you want to be happy for 1 month, get married. Of course, I put a footnote. Don't say because I'm a monk, I'm saying it. You can be happy for the rest of your life. Don't take it like... if you want to be happy for the rest of your life, get married. Okay, we go to the last one, which is very meaningful here. If you want to be happy for the rest of your life, help others. If you want to be happy for the rest of your life, help others. And if your job is not dealing so much with helping others, supplement it with volunteer work. And there's a lot of, plenty of opportunities to do volunteer work. So the second one, go on a vacation to refresh. Actually, when you come back, you'll be more fresh. That's why many jobs, they give you time to go for a vacation. So when you come back, at least you are fresh. You are fresh. Another one, direct your mind to positive aspects of your job, right? So then the fourth is purpose. This one, the fourth is align your purpose in life and the job. So align them together. So the purpose of life is to attain ultimate happiness. We are here to attain ultimate happiness. So find a job that is fitting, that's serving that purpose, so that whatever you're doing is in that service, right? So suitability, that's the number fifth. Trying to match your skill with your job, you always find meaning if you match your skills with your jobs. Then the sixth one is called domain. So one's job should be within the domain of the Noble Eightfold Path. In other words, don't do a job that manufacturing bombs, and it's going to, you will never find a meaning in your job that is just killing people, right? So then another one is motivation based on one's wisdom. So in other words, when you get your job, make sure that the motivation is out of your understanding, not out of your peer, not out of peer pressure, right? This is very, very important. Conclusion, find meaning in one's job is a key to happiness and productivity. In case one is unable to change the job, it's advisable to change one's attitude. Focus on the beatitude. That's very important. Count your blessing and not your curses. Beatitude. I'm playing with the words. Attitude, beatitude. Your attitude towards work can make a difference between suffering and happiness. So friends, I think this is my conclusion. And I would like to offer this for your reflection. And then we are going to have what we call Q&A session about this. I was a scuba diving instructor, in case you don't know what my job was. We used to say, as scuba diving instructors in PP Island, in Thailand, I used to live on a resort, we used to say, if you don't like your job, become a dive instructor. Because people pay you to have fun. So try to find out in life something that you love. Why? We go to work at 8:30. We come back when? 5? 4:30 here? Yeah, 6. 6. We spend a big chunk of our life at the workplace. We go home tired. A little bit of massage maybe here, watch TV and then sleep. So we spend more time actually at workplace. So I think that's why the Buddha recommended what we call right livelihood, because your job determines a lot what you are. It determines your happiness. So try to find a good job. And if it's not a good job, try to change your attitude towards that job. The more you become very grateful, the more you can see good things and hang in there. Thank you very much. Let me have the questions. I can read it. Oh, there's no question?
No.
Oh, raise your hand. No, don't worry if there's no box. There's no question in the box. Raise your hand, and then you can read it.
I would just go around and pass the microphone to anyone who wants to ask a question. So, yeah.
If no question, discussion. Discussion or comments or whatever. Tell us what makes you love your job. Or if there's any question, no problem. Okay, the Noble Eightfold Path. Yes, it's actually the path that leads to happiness. If you want to be happy, if your job doesn't make you happy, follow the Noble Eightfold Path. First and foremost, I'm very happy that you actually found your own job, because you are going to be your own boss. That means you love your job. That's another technique. try to be boss of yourself and create a job and all that. Okay, the Noble Eightfold Path is called right understanding. So in other words, you understand what suffering, the cause of suffering, happiness, and the way to happiness. So that's the first thing, what we call right understanding. It's called right view. Basically, that's what you have before you start a job. You must have a vision, isn't it? Did you just start your business without a vision?
No, I was doing something similar.
I'm doing it myself now. Yes. So you must have a vision, and there's a saying that if a vision without action is daydreaming, and action without a vision is a nightmare. Somebody say that as from England. I'm going to repeat that. Vision without action is daydreaming. All right? So you have a vision to start a Buddhist center in Uganda and you just sit in Australia. It's not going to work. How about that? So we switch off this. We don't need it.
Oh, yeah. I got some slides, which is after you talk to make some announcements.
Ah, okay.
Yeah,
Okay. Now, the thing is that vision without action is actually like a rocking chair. You know a rocking chair? You sit on a rocking chair, you do like this, but you're not moving anywhere. You seem like moving, but you're not moving anywhere. So the same thing, having right understanding, vision, it's good, but it's not good. You have to have action. So the same thing when you have right understanding, you understanding, before you set up for meditation, you must have understanding why you meditate. And also there's right understanding of law of karma, in other words, law of action and effects. That when you do this, you get this. When this happens, that's what is going to happen. So you must have that kind of right understanding. And then the next one is called right thoughts. You must have thoughts of generosity, thought of loving kindness, and thought of compassion. In other words, you let go of the thoughts of attachment, thoughts of hatred, and thought of cruelty. So that's what we call right thought. Because when you understand, it makes sense that your thoughts are going to be right. Because you have already right understanding, then you have right thoughts. Okay, then we go to the next one is called right speech. So speech, you should speak what is true, truth, you speak the truth, you speak what's kind, you speak what's harmonious, non-divisive, and speak what's meaningful. The opposite of that would be tell lies, would speak harsh speech, divisive speech, and meaningless speech. That's called blah, blah, blah. Have you ever heard about that? Blah, blah, blah. That's called, in Luganda we call, a very interesting name, okulungutana, okulungutana. In Pali it's called sampapalapa, papapapalapa. Sampapalapa is in Pali. And in English, you call it blah, 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 blah. No meaning. Just babbling words. Okupalapalanya. Actually, in Uganda, the proper word is okupalapalanya. Okupalapalanya. That's my language. Anyway, you understand. Thus, right speech should be meaningful. Should be truthful. Should be with kindness. And should be with what we call harmonious. It should promote harmony and concord and all this kind of thing. Then the fourth one is called right action. You remember I told you vision? Here our actions coming in. Then action is you actually abstain from killing, abstain from stealing, and abstain from sexual misconduct. The opposite of that, preserving life and protect life. Being contented, being generous, that's right action, and also calming one's senses, right? Or respect for relationship, marriage and all this kind of thing. Those relationships, we have to respect them. Okay, so that, the fourth one. So the fifth one is right livelihood. The way you earn your livelihood should be what we call right livelihood. So right livelihood, the Buddha spelled it out like this. You should not earn your living by selling weapons, by selling poison, by selling slaves, by selling meat, by, is that all? There are five of them. I think that's about it. Weapon, poison, liquor, there are five of them. Okay. Gambling?
Yeah, is that one
of them? Yeah, the Buddha didn't recommend that. but that's not part of the list. That's not part of the list. That's not part of the list. I'm talking about five things. What the Buddha recommended. People who want to live a good livelihood. But there are so many other things that come into play, you know. So then another one is called right effort. Effort, that means effort to prevent evil states of mind, like greed, hatred, and delusion, and fear, and all that thing. So you must have effort to prevent those things from happening, those states of mind from happening. And then you must overcome them if they come. And also there's effort to develop good states of mind, like generosity, loving kindness, and compassion, and all these things. And also not only to develop these states of mind, but also to maintain them when they have arisen, you maintain them. So then the seventh one is the most popular one. The most popular one, to the extent that people forget all others. Right mindfulness. I can shoot a deer with mindfulness. I'm going to shoot the kangaroo with mindfulness. Most people made mindfulness popular that they have forgotten about others. That also are necessary. And that's what they call meditation. It's one of them. There are others. The eighth one is called right concentration. That's the answer to your question. You concentrate your mind, and that means you overcome these states of mind like sensual pleasures, then aversion, sloth and torpor, sleepiness and dullness, restlessness and worry, and then doubt. Once you overcome those mental disturbances or hindrances or psychic irritants, then your mind becomes calm and peaceful. And then you gain into the first level of concentration, which is called jhana in Pali. But this is what we call right concentration, because there are four jhanas. The more you concentrate, you slide into the second and the third and the fourth. So then if you have concentration, then you have understanding. You get understanding. When you have understanding, the whole thing comes together, you know. So that's what we call Noble Eightfold Path, and that's what leads to purification of the mind, and that leads to enlightenment and ultimately to happiness. That's what you are doing. If you are meditating, my friend, that's what you are following. In fact, meditation is called bhavana. It means you have to follow the Noble Eightfold Path. Okay? Answered your question? Thank you very much. Okay, another question? I hope people, when they're meditating, when people meditating, oh, I can't meditate, oh, I can't concentrate, I can't concentrate. Most people, that's what they tell us. Oh, I'm meditating, but I can't concentrate. So I'm going to abandon meditation. I hate meditation because I can't concentrate. What about other seven factors? Because in meditation, you develop loving kindness, you develop patience, you develop generosity. Do you know how we develop generosity when we are meditating? Generosity means letting go. So if you can make your intention to come to meditate, that means you let go your time when you would spend playing cricket. So you have let go that time. So even that intention is good. It's quite good. You come here to meditate, and also you start letting go of difficult states of mind. You see? So then you develop right understanding from time to time. Of course, when you are meditating here, you are quiet. You are no longer speaking, so you don't have to worry about right speech. Hundred percent right speech, because you're not telling a lie, you are not telling a harsh speech, divisive speech. Right livelihood, you come to meditate, you want a cushion, right livelihood there, self-employed. You're self-employed on a cushion. So actually you're meditating here, but you are sitting here. So you have right livelihood when you are sitting on a cushion. Then right action. Of course, when you come to meditate, usually people take five precepts, and when they come here, so when you are meditating here, you are not worried that you are killing things or you are stealing things and all these things. So you can see that actually when you meditate, most people, they say, oh, I can't concentrate, then my meditation is not good. No. Maybe one out of eight is not good, but maybe you are getting better in other things by making your intention to come and meditate. It already is good enough, and then you sit here. That's already half of the practice. Half of the practice is to show up. Yeah. So then you can work your way to right understanding, right thoughts, right livelihood, even making an effort, right effort. So I think you are gaining so many things. The problem, most people focus only one thing that is not going right. That's the problem. People focus only one thing that's going wrong. People focus that they cannot concentrate. And I've already made an experiment. Like this. What do you see? What do you see?
There's a dot.
Ah, I got you. What about the white space?
Oh, okay.
So people just see only the dot, not the white space. So when people come meditate, I can't concentrate. The rest, you can't see. With the job, my boss is very harsh. But what about your coworkers? They just focus only one thing, and they lose the whole picture. They cannot even find meaning in life, and the job and all these things. So I think this is enough. I think time is up. I think I give... Okay, one more question maybe? Because you need to make announcements.
Yes,
so I want one question and give him 20 minutes. Because I'm supposed to finish at 9, isn't it?
Yeah,
I'm supposed to finish at 9, but it seems you don't have a question. Okay, let's go further because I think I have still time. But how many slides? How long is the slides going to take?
About 15 slides. But it will be quite fast anyway. So,
So can I give you 10 minutes?
Yeah, 10 minutes.
10 minutes are good?
Yep.
Okay, let's roll. Let's roll because I'd like you to hear questions, comments, and everything from you. Any question?
Sorry, this is a bit off topic, but I'm just wondering, why did you decide to become a monk? I understand that you used to work for Paul, and now you become a monk, so I'm just
Yes, that question is very dear to me, and thank you very much to ask that question. After working for 2 years in Thailand, I was super saturated with everything. I thought that having a job, this what I kind of thought after spending 5 years in India, and I was just... restricted with so many things. So when I went to Thailand, I said this is the perfect place to indulge myself. I wasn't a monk, I was a lay person, like any other person. I said this is the perfect place where I can get everything I've never got in life. And guess what? Thailand is a country that can give you whatever you have ever thought in life. I like Thailand, you know. And then I landed a job as a scuba dive instructor, and then I got exactly what I wanted. I wanted to be free. So, and I wanted a little bit of money, and I thought, of course I had meditated before, but I thought really getting a good job, that's the end of it. That's the best way to live one life, getting a job and money and do everything. I thought this will satisfy me, and then I tried it. And then I had to do a course, diving instructor and all these things. And then I ate all the food I wanted because it was a resort. I could eat every kind of food, Chinese, Thai, every food you can eat there, you know. And then I went for diving. I had all the best dives and everything. I had the best friends, students. And then after that, everything was up to here. I said, this is enough. Let me go back to Africa. When I went to Africa, people were waiting for me as a successful businessman. But I was meditating, shaved head. They were deluded, actually. I mean, they are disillusioned, you know. So then when I went to Africa, I was disillusioned. Everybody wanted to convert me. Everybody want to ask me, what are you? I say, I'm a Buddhist. So why did you leave us? Come and go to become a Christian. I said, no. I want to meditate. Then I left Uganda, and I went to meditate for 3 months. I went to USA to meditate for 3 months, meditate. Well, like this kind of retreat is like all what you do, sit, meditate, and eat. meditate and eat. 1 month, 2 months, 3 months. Those 3 months helped me to figure out what I like in life. After those 3 months, I said, should I become a scuba dive instructor? Or should I continue to meditate? I found out if I go to Florida, because that's where I was heading to be a course director, I say I'm going to do the same thing like I did in Thailand. And I'm going to be again frustrated. I'm going to get everything I want. But then at the end of that day, I say, so what? I didn't find the happiness. I could not find the happiness that I found when I was meditating. So since when I meditated for 3 months, I was feeling more happy and peaceful and all that thing, I found out which kind of thing I can do actually to continue this meditation and study and just be contented. I found out it's becoming a monk. So then I say, where do you become a monk? Imagine, I didn't become a monk in Thailand. I am in USA. I don't know if there's even a temple. I decided to become a monk in the United States. But the reason I came and become a monk is because of my boss. My boss was so harsh at me. My boss is called Mr. Dukkha, Mr. Suffering. Have you heard Dukkha, the word Dukkha? Dukkha means suffering. I was suffering a lot. Suffering not coming from not having food, but everything I was doing, it wasn't hitting that spot that I touched when I was in India in 1995, went to meditate for 12 days. And those 12 days, when I meditated, I felt, wow, this is amazing. So now when I went to do everything, working, I was in the US, I was working as an office personnel and a retreat manager in a retreat center. But that still was not, imagine I was in a meditation center working in a front office, but still I was missing something, the freedom to be free, you know, like to meditate whenever I want, I can decide to meditate for 3 months, 6 months, nobody is going to bother. But in my job as an office manager, retreat manager and in the office, they give you only 1 week, 1 day. Oh, I still like it. No, you have to come to lead a retreat. So I have to lead a retreat to be a retreat manager. So I found out how I can break free is to become a monk and then be on my devices. Now I have on my devices, go to Australia, go everywhere I can go. I don't have any tie. I don't have a wife to say, oh, you know, be here, let's go shopping and all these things, go to vacation. No. I have no boss. That's the answer. Thank you very much for asking. Having said that, you can go to the Mr. Google and do like this, Planting Dhamma Seeds. That's my book that explains you how I became a monk and how I started the temple in Uganda.
Thanks for that.
Okay, thank you for asking.
Thanks, Bhante, for sharing those wisdom of nuggets of wisdom.
Yes.
And I'm just going to change the slides.
Yes.
To the next one.
Mm-hmm.
So, maybe you could explain a bit more about your work in Uganda.
Right.
Just like, you know, in the coming months, what projects are you doing and what trips do you have ahead of you?
A brief one.
Yeah.
I can tell you my travels until only this year. Only this year. By the way, this year is very special to me. I'm turning 50 years. Can you imagine? I'm an old fellow, old monk. I'm 50 years and 10th is going to be my birthday. And it's going to find me here. I hope it will. I thought it will find me in India under the Bodhi tree where the Buddha got enlightened, because I'm Buddharakkhita. But unfortunately, they cancelled the meeting. I'm one of the person on a meeting in India. It's called the International Buddhist Confederation, and I'm one of the member. So I thought they invited me in exact time 7th, 8th, 9th, and 10th. So 10th is supposed to find me
sitting under the Bodhi tree, meditating so that I can put in another 50 years to spread Buddhism all over Africa because Buddhism delayed to go to Africa. No, it didn't happen. Guess what? You people, you have good karma. You are going to have me here on my birthday, not the Buddha. Not the Buddha. Okay, anyway. And then I'm going to leave here on 17th and go to lovely Sri Lanka for only five days until 25th of October. I'm just going to sign my research fellowship. The university gave me research fellowship, so I need to sign for my research work. I'm doing research work which is going to help Buddhism flourish in Africa. I'm telling you, I found out something like a catch, a bait. That once I finish my research, I can just keep on throwing in each country in Africa, and I know they will grab it. It's about healing transgeneration trauma using African wisdom and right mindfulness. In other words, this is the problem they have because of wars, and I'm telling them you can heal these problems using mindfulness and African wisdom. And each country there have their wisdom, so they are going to accept it. Whether they like or not, they are going to accept it because they are already Africans and they like their wisdom. I'll just smuggle in a little dose of Buddhism, a little bit, without even knowing. A little bit. Before they know, let's say if I have a talk 10 minutes, first 5 minutes, they will not know that even I'm talking about Buddhism. Because I've done this research very well. I'm spending many years to do this. Okay, then from there, I'm going to Oman. He's the one who connected me to Oman. I'm going to be teaching in Oman for 5 days, right? Everywhere I'm going for 5 days, 5 days. Okay, Oman, 5 days. I arrive in Uganda on 1st November. And guess what? The next day, I'm on airplane again to Burma. There's somebody who's sponsoring a project on building our schools and all these things. And he has already donated money to build the fences and all that. I need to see the donor and plan very well how we can continue with our projects. So, and also what's called Katina ceremony. So the major idea is Katina ceremony. And I stay in Burma for 5 days. And then once I leave Burma, guess what? Return to Uganda for only 1 day and fly to Morocco. Morocco, there's a conference of about climate change and the United Nations environment. Last time it was in Paris, but now it's in Morocco. Then I leave Morocco on November 17th, come back to Uganda, stay 1 day, fly to Singapore. In case you're interested with my schedule now, then go to Singapore to teach in Singapore. Once I finish teaching in Singapore, guess what? I'm back to Australia. These people here, they say, Venerable, we need you here. I'm coming here after teaching in Singapore on the 4th December. Then I'll stay there on Monday and then fly back to Melbourne and spend a new year with you here. And after New Year, guess what? Exactly after New Year ends, back on airplane to Singapore. Stay 2 days in Singapore, back to Uganda, and then I'll stay in Uganda and start my project. I can't wait to start the project I'm doing in Uganda. I'm having exciting projects. One is a water project, whereby we are going to supply water to the whole school. So we are raising money to supply water to the whole school. Guess what? That's how I can spread Buddhism in Uganda. If you tell people breathe in, breathe out, they will check out. In fact, one time I had a conference where I invited Minister of Tourism, and we had one person from the local chiefs there. She's a lady who wanted meditation. So now she wanted to meditate. And the Minister of Tourism is not a Buddhist. So she came late. So then she came at the same time when the Minister of Tourism came. And this is one of the, what's called Queen Mother of one of the king there. I said, can I compromise on meditation so that the Minister of Tourism can plant a tree? And then, you know what decision I made?
Let us meditate. Minister of Tourism there. When I opened my eyes, he wasn't there. Not a good idea. So what I do is to do this project like water projects and other things. African people will understand generosity, compassion. So I have a project for water, to supply water. Everywhere we are spreading Buddhism, we give them clean water. Because children and females, they go a long distance to fetch water. So I found out when I solve this problem, it's helping. In fact, when I put a water project one time there, they start calling me, buy Buddha, everywhere I go, buy Buddha. So now that's a project I'm doing. Another project is constructing Sima so that I can start manufacturing monks and nuns. There's no manufacturing plant there for monks and nuns. But now we have what we call a Sima, and now it's only the flat, there's no building. Already this year I ordained one monk from Rwanda. He's called Sangharakita. So, and Buddharakkhita is called Sangharakkhita. We need to manufacture Dhammarakkhita. Sasanarakkhita also ordained temporarily. So we need a small building where we can do the ordination. And some people here, they have already donated some money. And then there's a big project that I would like to start is called a school. I found out how, if I want to spread Buddhism in entire Africa, education, education, and education. This is what we call bring forth. So on the entire continent, there is no, as far as I know, there's only a place in South Africa. There's a Chinese who started a project which is called, African Buddhist Seminary. That's the only place where they have a school for studying Buddhism. The rest of the continent, with its 54 countries, there is no single school I know that teaches Buddhism. Not even a primary school. I want to start one where we can teach Buddhism from primary school, secondary school, and college level. Guess what? There's a university next to us. It's a Christian university. I called one father to be part of my research. When I went there to meet him, he's a father, this Roman Catholic. I found him listening to meditation. I said, "What are you listening?" He said, "You know, I love meditation, and this is a very good person. It's called Jack Confield." I said, "Jack Confield? Wait a minute. I always teach meditation with Jack Confield." I said, "You teach with Jack Confield?" Because he was listening to Jack Confield, who is from California. I said, "Well, this is a website. You can listen." He told me, "Let us start this school, whereby we can have what you call certificate courses. I'm going to do a diploma in Buddhism." So this father, Catholic father, want to do a diploma in Buddhism. So he told me, "Let us first start with certificate courses in Buddhism." So this is my project, friends. I would like to start schools, water project, and also build places at the Uganda Buddhist Center so that when I teach Buddhism, I mean meditation also, there are people where they can stay with accommodation. Now when I teach, people have to stay in a tent and it rains, so it's very difficult. So I have around 4 projects going on. Thank you very much for asking.